Ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again to coming to Eastside Virtual Reality Meetup. Thank you for being here. Starting off with some community announcements. Thanks again to Apex Systems for providing us this wonderful space, this delicious and bountiful pizza and salad, which I've enjoyed. Please check to make sure that your phones are not set to the loudest setting possible. But while you have your phones out, in case you like to use Twitter or social medias, you can take pictures and send tweets out. Our Twitter handle is @ESIDEVR. That's EastsideVR. Let's see. For wherever it's relevant to not use the @ symbol, you can use the hashtag #EastsideVR. Of course, hashtag VR, XR, MR, all the R's. I'm actually really excited for tonight's presenter. I'm not sure if he knows it, but I credit him for being the person that actually got me into VR. VR was an interest of mine, and I reached out to our guest tonight, Ryan Budenow, to ask some questions about where VR was headed. I was working for a startup at the time doing some research, and he really recommended that what I should do is go to the Seattle VR Meetup and just experience it for myself. And from that moment forward, I have been eyeballs deep in VR and loving every minute of it. So one of the other things that I am excited for bringing here tonight is that I, over the course of the past year, I have adopted Eastside VR, and I'm its main organizer, and I am joined by two core organizers, Carly Jean Keenow. Please give her a round of applause. And Carly Wood, who couldn't be here this evening, but she is also fantastic. The demos that we have tonight from Rob and Tiago are local developers in our community, and I just reached out to them and invited them to come do their demo. If you guys have VR demos, AR demos, and want to show them at our event, please get in touch with me or reach out to us on one of the social medias. Also, if you'd like to present, speak, or talk about your experience in VR, whatever it is, positive or negative, we'd be happy to have you come speak. One of the other things that I'm really proud about this community, not only that we get new people showing up each month that either have never tried VR or have never been to Eastside VR Meetup, is that this is a place for community, but also for wanting to spend our lives and our livelihoods in this industry. So I want to ask, show of hands, who here is working in VR right now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6, 7, 8, 9. That's 9's good numbers. Okay, now who wants to work in VR right now? That's good. Some of the same people. This guy's like, maybe not. Honesty is really important. So that's good. Also about 9. Some of the same overlapping Venn diagram there. Now who here is hiring for VR? Oh, it's Dan and Justin. All right, so we have some representatives from Google and Oculus here today. Thank you guys for joining us. So you saw them raise their hands. As soon as this the main presentation is over, I'm sure they're going to be mobbed and people are going to be shoving resumes at you. Oh, and Paolo. Paolo. Yes, and Paolo's hiring as well for Tosolini Productions. Does anyone else have something to mention about the community or about something that's coming up that they want to say or share?
I don't know if it's about the community, but it's about me. I would like to connect up with anybody here who would like to anonymously or not anonymously share their experiences demoing AR, VR for the general public, especially disasters, but also good things. Could be your parents, could be a demo of your product out in the field. I'm kind of putting some things together for a publication. So if you could connect with me either through the meetup RSVP or through here a little bit after, or Bridget@augmenteddiscourse.com.
Bridget at Augmented Discourse.
Yes, spelled just like that.
Excellent. All right. Without further ado, will you please join me in an extremely warm Eastside VR welcome, Ryan Budenow.
Thank you, Drew. That was really sweet. I'm Ryan Budenow, and essentially I'm a writer. And whether I realized recently that whether I like it or not, part of the byproduct of my life is that once in a while I produce a book. So this is Shape of Reality at the time, just sort of fell out of me because I had been blogging about VR in the Pacific Northwest for the last 2 years. And I had a blog, or I still maintain a blog, called starboardreality.com. And I've written a couple articles about the Seattle VR scene for Seattle Met Magazine and some other places. And I looked at this pile of writing and I realized, oh, that's a draft of something, that's an act, that's maybe it's a book. And so I put together, and then I had a friend who said to me one day, he said, hey, I think I want to start a small press. And I said, well, I think I might have a book. And he said, sure, I'll publish your book. And I'm like, deal. And so that was it. And so Owl Factory Press is the local small press. And I wanted to create something that was sort of small and represented not too much of a time commitment to somebody. You know, you can give this to someone and they wouldn't frown because it was like, oh God, I don't want to read that huge book. So it's just, it's like a poetry book, really. There's, you know, it's about 100 pages long. And it collects the some of the pieces that I've written in the last 2 years, but also some additional pieces. My career has been really weird in that it's been sort of a combination of technology and the poverty of the arts industry combined with teaching and with a little bit of community organizing. A few years ago, I learned about an organization called the UNESCO Creative Cities Network, and it's a network of cities around the world that are recognized for different art forms, for their contribution to literature, or music, or design, or gastronomy, and film is another one. And so I worked on this project for a couple of years to get Seattle designated a UNESCO City of Literature. And that had me traveling to 5 countries around the world and meeting with different people from different places, from Uganda, Iran, Iraq, Ireland, Reykjavik, Dublin, Norwich, England, all over the place. And I became aware of this community of people around the world who are working on ways to address how cities can foster cultures that give rise to different kinds of art. So, for instance, you know, we all know that Hollywood is a big, you know, it's the movie center of the world. Other cities become known for different things over time. So, I was the prime demographic for grunge rock in the early 90s. I grew up here in the Northwest, and I ended up going to Evergreen State College, starting on the day that Nirvana released Nevermind in the hometown where they live. So I felt like I had completely arrived, and I had the flannel and the jeans and the Mud Honey t-shirt and the mosh pits, and the, you know, I had a band. And at the time, I didn't realize that I was participating in a creative economy. So I was contributing my creativity to this little scene in Olympia. I was writing songs, I was playing music with my band, we were playing shows. We were also consuming releases from big bands like Soundgarden and Nirvana, but also small indie bands that would travel through town and play shows. I was writing reviews and zines, I was collecting 7-inch singles and going to the record store on the day certain things were released. And you know, I was just immersed in this music. And the one of the key things that I remember about that time is that no one ever sort of told me to do that, right? Like, I wasn't motivated by anybody saying, okay, you need to participate in a music scene. It was something that just sort of came from within. And I've reflected on that experience and realized over time, and being involved in this UNESCO project, that we have these creative economies that can grow and evolve in certain ways. And when we look back in time and we look at like a renaissance, like a period that's creatively fertile in a particular place, we can often think that those situations happen because there just happened to be genius artists who lived at that time and in that place, or you know, lightning struck in a particular way that enabled the beat writers to get together at that particular time, or Florence, Italy with Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo. And you know, we think of these things as almost like random occurrences. But I think when you look a little closer, you can see that these creative scenes, these moments, these cultural moments where things kind of pull together, and a lot of great art is generated. You can engineer those moments. You can make decisions to embrace that, and you can create these sort of self-fulfilling prophecies that allow for particular art forms to grow. So during the grunge era, what happened was, you know, I was a kid living in Conway, Washington on 7 acres with a dozen sheep, and I had a guitar and I had an amp and I had, you know, I put the singles on, I would listen and play the music, and I realized that there was cool stuff happening in Seattle. There was really cool music coming out of Seattle. And my own story was that I was, you know, a little creative weirdo making my dumb songs with my friends. But that little story connects to a bigger story, right? So you take your story and you say, okay, this is what I'm doing in the sphere of my life, but dang, now is exactly the time to be doing that, because look at who else is doing this. Look at this organization or this band over here or this record label, or this is the hot place to be. And so it's this cycle where it encourages people to get involved. It encourages people to take part in the growth of a creative economy. So when in 2016, I was in a place where I had been sort of butting my head against the employment wall for a while, and I wasn't sure what I really wanted to do next. And I started thinking about writing a screenplay, and then I thought about part of the screenplay could be produced by like a video game company, right? And so I thought, oh, what's going on with video games right now? And so I started researching and I realized, oh, Seattle in the Pacific Northwest is one of the greatest places in the world for video game companies, for indie video games. And then I sort of read a little bit more and realized, oh, wait a minute, virtual reality is coming back. And I remembered the sort of 80s, late 80s iteration of virtual reality, reading about Jaron Lanier and about, you know, the research that Tom Furness had done at UW. But then it sort of faded away. It sort of disappeared for a while. But then it came back, and I started to learn, oh, there's startups in Seattle that are devoted to virtual reality. Now, I want to find out more about this stuff. So I went, you know, I applied for a job at a startup. I didn't get it, but I learned. I talked to the founder, and he told me about, you know, the VR meetups. And so I went to a meetup, and I saw these people with these devices and working on these experiences and games, and it was utterly fascinating. And I thought, okay, now I want to be part of this, and I want to see where this goes. And so I started writing about this community, and I wrote an article for Seattle Met about the Seattle VR scene. And I realized while I was writing it that part of the job of a writer is to sort of reflect a community back to itself, right? To say, here, I'm going to hold up a mirror and show you what you look like from this perspective. And everybody in the community is sort of doing their own thing most of the time. And their heads down, and then they sort of look up and they see, oh, wait a minute, I'm part of a bigger story. I'm part of something like greater than just my own efforts. And so I purposely wrote this article in such a way that I thought, what I really want to have happen out of this is that people really get excited about this stuff. They really get inspired to jump into VR and to start making stuff. Because the only way that this will work is if it sort of operates like the grunge scene did in the early 90s, where you have people who are really self-motivated to take part in it. And then the magical thing that happens is when you bring people together like this, and you start seeing ideas spark off of each other, and new ideas start growing. And no one has the answers to everything, but everyone has a little piece of the puzzle. And you watch people as they try to put that puzzle together. So it's been an incredibly gratifying experience for me as a writer to discover this story, because it was like I found a little piece of it, and then suddenly it opened up into this whole world. And in addition to writing, so the way I make a living is I'm a consultant for a company called Immersion Networks, which is a R&D lab in Redmond that's working on an immersive audio platform that will be very applicable to VR. And so last week, I went to LA for the VR LA conference, and I gotta say, I was sort of lukewarm on the whole thing, really. I mean, it was fine, but I didn't really feel like waiting in line for like an hour to pretend to shoot something. So, but there's some
waiting
really,
in line,
you know,
for an hour to what?
To shoot something, you know. So I think that, you know, there are two things sort of at play here. One is that initial excitement about VR that got all of us involved in it was based on something very real. And on the other hand, these things take time. And we're in this sort of period where the sort of core people in the community, I think, are still plugging away at it. But I don't think our culture has evolved to the point where it's ready for that complete enmeshment with this new technology. But I think it's coming. And I'm curious to see, you know, I look back at, like, you know, my experiences with computers. My dad was a civil engineer, and he had these clunky HP and Hewlett Packard computers and Texas Instruments, and, you know, they did engineering calculations. And I remember, like, 1980, 81, 82, think about what a computer did back then, right? And then think about the distance from that to Amazon, you know? Like, that's 94 was when Amazon came out. So you had, like, a good, you know, 15 years. So it's really fascinating to me to see what's happening at this stage, because there's some disappointment, but there's some faith that this is going to continue to evolve, and it certainly seems to be the case. So anyway, typically how one of these, like, or a book event goes is the author reads something from the book and people ask questions, and reading, like, literary readings tend to be one of the most boring kinds of entertainment that you can actually have. Like, it's just, and it's also really, like, one of the easiest, right? So you just sit up, stand up here and read something, you know, you don't even have to memorize it. So I brought books. I think I have enough for everybody. And I'm happy to just give them to you guys. But I would be also happy to answer questions now. And if you want, maybe that'll lead into something that'll read, but maybe not. I'm sure. So why don't I open it up for questions? So yeah, Drew.
Well, one of the things that I've appreciated about you and your documenting of our VR culture is that I kind of view you as our own personal historian. But as you mentioned, showing the mirror to a culture, I'm curious, how often has it been that you show somebody in our contemporary VR, XR scene what you see, and they disagree with you?
Well, I don't know first of all, I don't like comments on my blog, so I don't know. So I took care of that problem. The only thing that I think, like, I wonder, I check myself a little bit, and I wonder if I've overhyped something, you know? Like I look back on stuff I wrote. When I was putting this book together, I looked at all my blog posts, and I was cherry-picking which ones I thought would last, you know, would have some longevity. And the stuff, like, early on where I was like, ooh, like, is the Vive gonna do this or that, or, you know, and I was really kind of in the nitty-gritty, the industry stuff, I've been largely wrong about, I think. I don't trust my own opinions on that. The thing that's more interesting to me is, you know, I studied, when I was in college, I studied the history of media, so I learned about how television and cinema and radio and all these different media technologies in the 20th century came to be. And I also was very interested in how technology changes us as individuals and as a culture. So how we are, you know, what are the sociological impacts of introducing a new media technology? How does social media change our behavior in the political sphere? We don't passively just receive information through various media. As we were, you know, as we're watching television, our physiology is different than it is when we're reading a book. You know? And we, when we're listening to the radio, we're forming pictures in our mind that we don't have to do when watching television. So VR to me feels like a culmination of all these different media technologies, and it's almost as though the 20th century was just the groundwork for this new medium. You know, like I think that it combines cinema, narrative, music, visual art, drama, and it just rolls it all up in one. And also has, you know, potential therapeutic benefits and applications for architecture and engineering. It's vast. So yeah, I think I tend now to lean more on that stuff because I don't think that I'm really a play-by-play kind of commentator when it comes to the image.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm curious what you think are the, I mean, you mentioned grunge, right? So there's a set of cultural environment here in Seattle.
Yeah.
You can point to things about it that were instrumental in the birth of grunge.
Yeah.
You know, sort of like after the decline of the economic decline when Boeing sort of downsized, but right at the beginning of Starbucks and Microsoft's ascent, and so the economic conditions were there, and there was the cultural conditions of like synth pop of the 80s and the reaction against that. I'm curious if you think there are, what you think are the cultural conditions in Seattle today that are conducive to something interesting happening.
Well, I think thinking nationally, it's never felt as unreal to be an American right now. Like, it just, when you, like the news feed that I wake up to every morning, like, I think I've become so numb to it now. I'm like, all right, like, yeah, porn star, whatever. Like, it's the stuff that is happening politically right now is so overwhelming, and if you transplanted that back into like the Reagan era, like any one of these things would have like completely toppled the whole administration, right? Like, but now it's just, we get this bombardment, right? And we're constantly on our phones, and we're just being hit with information, boom, boom, boom. And the problem that I see, you know, having worked within the arts community and knowing a lot of writers, in Seattle in particular, the thing that concerns me is that it seems like we're coming into a place where you can't live here unless you are involved in technology. Like, you just, this area is not for you unless you have
even if you're involved in technology.
What's
you
that?
You can get pushed out of it. Like, I'm 61 years old and I'm having trouble finding a job because I feel like I'm being discriminated against to some degree because of my age. And I've been doing software for 30 years now.
Yeah.
And I'm realizing that I don't own a house here. I probably can't stay here unless I can get a job again.
Right.
It's just too expensive.
Right, right. Well, I know, and it's scary. Jaron Lanier recently said that he you know, he's the VR pioneer, right? You know,
VR goes all the way back when you start looking at the stereo pairs that they were doing with photography before movies ever even came along. It's got a very old history. It starts back at the turn of the century, 1900s. And there's iterations all the way through that. There was a lot of VR research done in the 1950s. So it goes much farther back than that.
Oh, sure. Well, you could argue too, it's like when artists started to work in perspective.
Well, but I'm saying people were actually trying to do stereotype stuff, which is really the earliest forms of VR.
Sure, yeah. Well, my point was that, so Jaron Lanier recently said something about how if you're in the tech world, everything it seems pretty okay, but then once you get out of it, like, everyone's struggling, and it's concerning, and I don't know if I really want to get to that Ready Player One world where everyone's living in stacks and, you know, and escaping into VR. I don't know if I really, I'm not comfortable with the idea of VR being escape from the real world. I think that it's it can be like a mirror to the real world. Once you get out of VR, like, what does the world look like to you then?
What gets you you really fired up about VR?
Really fired up about VR?
Yeah.
Well, lately it's been audio stuff. It's been audio experiences and music and social media like that. I think the first, like, there, I have an essay in here about the Wave VR. Has anyone tried the Wave?
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. It's like a dance party in another planet. And one weekend, there was a weekend where I tried the Wave, and I was blown away by it. It was just like, I was stunned. And then that same weekend, I went and saw the Fast and Furious 8 at Regal Cinema. Fate of the Furious, rather. And they have this thing called 4DX. Has anyone ever done this? Like, okay, I don't recommend this for anyone who's older than, say, 25. So, 4DX, so I get into the, I buy my ticket. It seems a little bit more expensive than usual. I'm like, oh, they raised the prices, whatever. I go into this theater and the seats look different, right? And I'm like, oh, they look like hard plastic. And I sit down and I look in the armrest and there's a button that says water on off. And I go, oh my God, what the hell? Like, what am I doing here? So I turn it to off. And as soon as the movie started, like the section of seats, it was like four seats together, like started to move like this, right? Huh. Right? And then there was like during fight scenes, like you get punched in the back, right? And like there's like air blows at you and like mist and like flashing light. Oh. And it was like you're being controlled in this environment. And like 10 minutes into it, I was thinking, I'm totally getting my money back. I'm like getting out of here, this is bullshit. I don't want to deal with this. And then like 11 minutes into it, I thought, God damn it, this will be such a good topic for an essay. Damn it, okay. So I'm gonna stick it out. So I was there the whole movie, and like at the end, you could totally divide the audience into like generations. I mean, it was like the 40-year-olds, 40-somethings like me, like we're walking out of there literally like this. I mean, we're totally like our backs in this horrible. And like the 20-something guys were like, that was awesome, you know? And I'm like, but the thing that I experience having those two things close together was that there were two totally different philosophies about immersion, right? One is the Wave, where you are put into an environment where you can interact with other people's avatars and you can have little experiences together, and it's so trusting of the user, right? So the user is empowered to explore a place. In this 4DX experience, it was some engineer decided at this point when Jason Stratham is busting out of prison, I'm just gonna punch the audience in the back a bunch of times, right? Because that'll be cool. But it was a very top-down controlling idea of immersion. And I think that what I would be interested to see is more experiences where your natural curiosity is rewarded, where you are able to navigate through a space and discover wondrous things and meet people. And I think that's what it's about. It's a real roundabout way of answering the question. There you go.
I just had a thought when you were talking about the different elements which really go into storytelling, and our experiences really are for the most part storytelling, whether they're films or advocacy or games. And sometimes I think, you know, when we talk about a mediated experience or a firsthand experience, we talk about, you know, you're reading a ghost story in a book, and you know you're in this room and you close the book and you might think about it or you might not, right? And that's one level of experience. And then your best friend tells you this ghost story that happened to them, and now your mirror neurons are firing, and you're like, I'm scared, but I'm still in this room. And those are mediated, right? So once we step into a fully architected VR experience, it almost blurs the line between a mediated experience and a firsthand experience, because someone else has created this storytelling space, but it's feeding your inputs, your sensory inputs directly. So there's you're bypassing everything that makes it storytelling and making it firsthand. And I think that that's just a kind of a really interesting, blurry place that our minds are not quite equipped to differentiate.
Yeah.
And when you said, like, you're not really looking forward to the Ready Player One space, I also think of how many, when we think of demographically, you know, in 20 years, the number of like 87-year-olds they're going to be is staggering, and these are people who may or may not have a social safety network behind them because of the recession and everything. So the number of people right now who sit in nursing homes like blankly in front of TVs, I feel like VR is going to be like an element of our elder care system. Which may be more engaging.
And they have started doing that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I know that's where the very tip of that. But right now it's like entertainment versus like, how do we get 10 people in a little white room? So anyway, it was just that difference between stepping through mediated experience and back into firsthand in
yeah.
a really funny way.
Well, and I became really intrigued by VR when I heard about it as a storytelling platform. And it was really interesting to me because I came from this sort of Seattle's literary community where everyone's sort of fighting over the same five adjunct gigs. And, you know, and there's a glut of storytellers, right? So there's way more than we need in a way, and like our economy can support. And then moving from there into a sort of a tech framework and hearing like all these CEOs and various people talking about how important storytelling is. And to my mind, I was like, oh, finally, like I found the place where my skills apply. And the other thing that I think is interesting about that is that I think that you can break down the word storytelling, and I think you can think about it more, I think you can consider it less as a question of how do you tell a story, or what components are there of a story? And instead ask, why do we like stories? What do we get out of stories? And I think stories are a way for us to train ourselves and train each other to solve problems. And I think that's what we do in our everyday life. We're constantly telling stories about ourselves and relating to each other through narrative. And masterful storytellers come up with clever ways of presenting problems and presenting characters, either solving them or being crushed by them. And I think that culturally, we're heading into an era where there are going to be a lot of very exotic and strange problems that we're gonna have to contend with. And perhaps VR is a medium that can attend to some of those. And in fact, that video earlier was very lovely. I totally got it. You know, when you're showing like the percentages of what you do or what you know, if you commit to this or you know, more electric cars or Paris and the port, and seeing that, I was like, oh, okay, yeah, that totally makes sense. That's like, yeah, if you put that in front of somebody and say, okay, you just move these knobs. These are the ways you can adjust a society. I think that's great. I think, and that's an example, I think, of a novel way of using medium to convey something that we get, you know, we like immediately get it. You don't have to really go into a lot of explanation behind it because you can see it happening. Those are the kinds of things that I get. Like, so. What else? Yeah.
What do you think are the biggest hurdles that are preventing VR from becoming like more mainstream right now? Two-part question. And when do you think it will become mainstream?
Well, I mean, again, we're back to the dial-up modem era, right? The hardware will continue to evolve. Experiences will evolve out of being sort of mimicking games into something more creative. I think the other thing too is that anytime I hear or like get a sense that there's a company that's gonna make a huge play and they wanna fucking own this space and it's gonna be, you know, they're gonna dominate, man, they're gonna be like the big player, you know, it really kind of, I get very disappointed in that attitude because the artistic media doesn't evolve because of one person with a lot of money we throw it at. It happens through these happenstance interactions with communities of motivated creative people, right? So you have, you know, if anyone could tell you, okay, I have something, and for a $600 investment, I can return that. I can turn that $600 into $15 million. Who wouldn't want to like invest in that? Well, that's essentially Nirvana's first album, Bleach. That cost $600 to make and went on to sell $15 million so far around that. So you never can predict. You can never like engineer or the complete like scene like from the get-go, but you can make conditions more favorable to these accidental interactions and accidental connections and collaborations happen. Like, I love going to hackathons because it's like you see these groups of four and five people and it's like rock bands, you know, it's like each person has their individual role, they're inspiring each other. And I think that I have a little thing here about competition. And I think if you compete in the spirit of an artist, which is not to completely destroy all the other artists, in a zero-sum game, right? You never have a band say, oh, we want to be the best band and make it so that no one listens to any other bands. Like, no one ever says that. Like, you have a good band, and they play, and then they see another band that's really good, and they're like maybe a little jealous, but they're also taking notes, right? They're like, ooh, that's cool. Oh, we can totally do something like that. I mean, you saw it with like the Beatles and Brian Wilson, you know, people competing and climbing the ladder together. I would hope that would be the spirit in which, you know, we're able to ascend together.
Sort of a tiny bit of pushback about that, little bit, and I'm not affiliated with the two giant companies right now who maybe are saying the thing. Nirvana was content. Nirvana wasn't selling CD players or record players. Like, somebody did have to put in truckloads of money and standardization to make the platform. So I am really happy that there are these big companies going platform, platform, platform. And I'm not, we begin to see the walled gardens come down in terms of content already a little bit, that they're playing a little nicely. So I'm not sure if that's pushback against you, if you're just talking about content versus structure, because I do think we need the big people. I love everybody in this room, but they're not going to be making the $10 million investment in optics and things
That's a really excellent point. I mean, you have to have pressing plants that make CDs, you have to have distribution centers, you have to have stereos, but another part of that, there's another level of that, which is that the label that Nirvana's first album came out was Sub Pop, which was started by two guys at Evergreen. And I remember, and I talk about this in the book, the spirit of that era was really all about empowering individuals and little groups of people. And the attitude for the sort of punk rock attitude in the early 90s was like, oh, you don't see the kind of music that you like out there? Why don't you make it? Like, oh, if you don't see a record label that'll carry the kinds of bands you like, let's start a record label. You know, it's this entrepreneurial attitude that I think when widely distributed, yields really surprising things. But I think you make a really good point about, you know, obviously someone needs to invest in these sophisticated pieces of hardware and also platforms to get out there. So, but I think that, you know, the more I can have a more the merrier attitude about it. I don't think that, I'm hoping that people are able to coexist.
So we're talking about ways of communicating different stories and things like that, and storytelling in VR. When you're looking at the state of VR in your research at time, what other forms of storytelling did you find in VR? Like Wave, what we want, computer games, did you find any other interesting ways of telling stories?
Yeah, so what I'm working on right now with Immersion Networks is, so they've created an audio platform that allows you to move sound objects in space and to perceive distance and direction cues with this incredible fidelity. And so what I've started to do is think about, okay, what kind of story could you tell only using that technology, right? So what are sort of audio-only kind of experiences that you can tell? One idea that I had, it was this story called The Boring Date. And in The Boring Date, you put headphones on and you're listening to this, and it feels as though you're sitting in a cafe, right? And you're across the table from a guy who's droning on and on and on about his boring job, right? And he just keeps talking, blah, 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 just monotone about his boring job. It's like the most fun one. And it was really fun to write really boring dialogue. It was like writing about, like, oh yeah, we have a lot of envelopes and office supplies at the office. But one of the things that you can do with this technology as well is you can exploit what's called the cocktail party effect, which is our ability to tune out different sources of sound, right? So while this guy is talking at the table, you hear conversations happening at the other tables, and you start to eavesdrop because this person just received horrible news that someone had been in a really terrible accident, and someone over here mentions gonorrhea, right? And you're like, what, you know? So I'm really interested in exploiting our ability to focus our attention in different areas, right? And to do that in a audio environment. So, those are the kinds of things I'm working on these days. I'm really curious about how, you know, because audio has been sort of the afterthought to a lot of VR, and I think rightly so. I mean, it's like pretty astonishing when you put on a headset the first time and you're like looking around, you can see 360 degrees, and like I was totally blown away just by that. I didn't need audio for it, but I think that going forward, audio is going to become more and more of a differentiator.
Look how much difference it makes in movies.
Yeah.
Without a soundtrack, movies don't have any suspense
right.
or anything.
Have you ever seen the thing where they edited the last part of the first Star Wars movie where they get the awards, and all I can hear is like C-3PO's like feet on the ground, and then all of a sudden out of nowhere Chewbacca just goes and then everyone else is just kind of quietly standing there.
The soundtrack is so important to the movie, it's not funny.
I went to sound design school, right? And the first thing they showed us was chunks of Star Wars without audio.
Yeah.
And it's like, this is so dumb. Like, you know what I mean? And then when you hear it with the music and the dialogue and the sound of the boom, 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 you know what I mean? And you're just like, oh my God, it just brings it to life. But being a producer, audio is always the afterthought, and that's just going to be.
Yeah.
What VR is really still missing is haptic feedback.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's the hard thing. That is going to be the hardest thing to make so that it's realistic. I mean, this thing you went to with the blowing on you and the beating you in the back was a really rudimentary attempt at that. But I mean, we're so far from having true haptic feedback that so much research and development still needs to go into that before we can really get immersive, completely immersive.
Yeah.
But they've made a lot of strides. Like, there's a glove that really feels nice, and there's a local entrepreneur that makes like haptic feedback vests that I've tried that, you know, are really nice as well.
For me, I always wanted to, ever since I worked on VR in graduate school, I wanted to build design systems based on allowing you to design so rapidly that you can just do it in your hands and use the computer itself to give you precise measurements and everything else. But you need haptic feedback, not just visual feedback, to do precise positioning. You need some pushback on your fingers and everything. And all that comes into play. And I'm so disappointed career-wise, because I was working on this stuff in graduate school, just stereo imaging, but it was still VR, because we were doing it in real time on screens in front of you. It wasn't a helmet. It was basically a screen. It was a window into a VR environment. And I thought I would work in this field. And I'm 61 now, I've been working for 30 years and still have never really worked on VR in my career. Even though I came out of graduate school thinking I could find something, there was nothing. And there's been really nothing going on my whole career that I've ever been able to wheedle myself into somehow. And that's kind of depressing in a way to me at this age, since I was working on it all the way back in graduate school. And we're talking about 1983, 84, 85
time frame, so. But yeah, I mean, this stuff is
a whole story. Yeah. So.
Has this inspired any little bit of reading that you want to do to us?
Oh,
you said that our questions
Yeah, sure.
Our questions might have inspired you.
Sure. I'll read about the 4DX experience.
Oh, thank you.
Sure. Okay. Speaking of movies, the same week I experienced The Wave, I also saw Fate of the Furious at Seattle's Regal 16, a theater that recently upgraded a number of its auditoriums with plush recliners. While I was apparently not paying attention, the theater added something called 4DX, which means your seat physically moves and you occasionally get mist sprayed in your face. Imagine getting alternately fanned and spritzed while sitting on a washing machine and spin cycle while a toddler kicks you in the back. It's exactly as fun as that. About 10 minutes into the movie, I was prepared to leave and ask for a refund, but then I realized that this experience would be great fodder for an essay, goddammit. And during the 4DX, Fate of the Furious, right after having my mind blown by The Wave, exposed a yawning chasm between movies and VR, what pissed me off about the 4DX experience was that I had no agency whatsoever. I was expected to passively accept the jolts and rumbles some engineer in Burbank or Pasadena had determined that I should feel. I'm sitting there watching Jason Statham pummel his way out of a maximum security prison while the world's most incompetent robot masseuse is using my chakras. After 2 hours of this, I stumble out of the theater having received a message loud and clear that I am too old for this shit. An attitude shared by another Gen X dude behind me who remarked, "Well, that sucked." The only element of 4DX that I found remotely nifty was the slight ocean breeze that wafted into my personal space when Vin Diesel's Dominic Toretto shows up beachside in Cuba. Otherwise, the experience was exactly the opposite of immersive. The gluteal rumbles and spinal rattling lurches pushed my attention away from the movie, which, incidentally, was a pretty great installment in the franchise. There was Charlize Theron as the baddie, a steely dreadlock Furiosa by way of Coachella, hell-bent on taking a nuclear sub for a spin. There was Shakespeare-grade dialogue like, "I've seen that look in his eyes before. Dominic Toretto has gone rogue." And there was the wonder that it's Vin Diesel, who acts like how a dildo would act if a dildo studied the Stanislavski method. In 4DX, the dildo vibrates. Needless to say, the movie left me bruised on a weekend when Father John Misty's new album, full of deprecations of our brave new immersive age, ran loops in my head, and our reality star president rattled his nuclear sabers against an autocrat just as unhinged as he. Is it enough to let ourselves be entertained to escape from our news feeds for a precious couple hours to surrender to a chiropractic nightmare? Is this what the arms race of sensation demands? Is our future one in which we'll offer ourselves up to sit compliantly in our seats, our bodies shaken and souls unstirred? Or one in which we'll meet strangers from the other side of the earth in alien landscapes, our identities abstracted into avatars that bear no trace of the races formed in the course of humanity's viral dominion of the globe? Fate of the Furious' epic centerpiece sequence involves hundreds of self-driving cars that get hacked and driven like a tsunami of vehicular homicide through Manhattan. This is the second movie I've seen recently, the first being Logan, which features self-driving vehicles, which we all seem to accept are coming any day now. The act of driving, one of the things we assumed only humans could do, is about to be forfeited to the machines, and therein lies a primal, blood-eyed anxiety that the movie adroitly exploits. How ironic, then, that a movie that taps our fear of no longer being in control of the wheel has been paired with a new next-generation cinematic concept that emphatically communicates that the machines have authority over your body, not the other way around. We find ourselves at a fork in a proverbial road, to belabor a metaphor. One route offers us more sophisticated methods of to surrender our free will. Another offers human connection and psychedelic playgrounds built in code. Both offer a way to satiate an irrepressible human need for community. I think the real reason why audiences from Hong Kong to Seattle flock to the Fast and Furious movies, beyond the laughably improbable close calls and their military-industrial pyrotechnics, is their appeal for us to envision ourselves as belonging to a transracial family spanning languages, continents, and transportation preferences. Just as we yearn to be thrilled, we ache for ways to bridge our differences. I think it is in virtual reality, not cinema, where we're going to cross those bridges. Thanks. I brought a bunch of books, and I'm happy to hand them out. I don't know if I have exactly as much as there are people in here, but I hope so. So yeah, I'll just set them up here. Yeah. Thank you so much again for inviting me.
Well done, on brand. Thanks again. One giant round of applause, Ryan. Good enough. And now comes the show and tell and play time. We've got this asymmetrical VR experience called
Scare B&B.
And do you guys want to come up and tell us about it real quick? You don't have to, but come on up.
YouTube wants to know.
Yes. All right, so tell us who you are.
Hi, I'm Tiago.
How it got started. Go.
I'm Tiago.
I'm Rob.
And we started this game called Scare B&B basically for the idea that we saw when people play VR games in groups, there's one person in a headset and everyone else just standing around watching.
And people that have VR headsets want to show it off to their friends and family, but stepping into VR is an inherently isolating experience. You are stepping into a different reality. So we got together and kind of chatted some ideas.
How we did it, yeah. And that was around a little bit before Halloween. So like, well, let's make something for that. So I don't know how we arrived to Airbnb to scare Airbnb, but once we created it, we saw that people really like the idea of killing their friends in a house using traps. So that's basically what you're doing in the game. You're in a house in VR and you're going around trying to find some keys. And people are in their cell phones trying to get the person in VR. Yeah.
And we ideally want to use cell phones in the sense that people use their own device. You don't have to have a specialist controller or you know some sort of subscription model through the internet. You literally just pull out your phone, turn on the app, and join in the game.
Yeah. Is it available for download at any place?
It will hopefully be released this October.
Excellent.
Yeah, right around for Halloween.
All right, well, check it out. It's in the back corner. Scare B&B. Thank you very much. We have Justin from Oculus here. I saw you brought a unit, but I also brought my own that people can play with in case you don't want other strangers' fingerprints on yours. So we've got one of the Oculus Go headsets back there. Also, Paolo Tosolini of Tosolini Productions brought a HoloLens. You have some demos? Do you want to come up and show people about it? Thank you.
So my name is Paolo Tosolini. I'm the founder of Tosolini Productions. We're a digital agency and innovation lab based here in Bellevue. We work very closely with Microsoft. We have done a few experiences with HoloLens, and you're welcome to try them out. We love to do mashups of different technologies, like 3D scans and HoloLens, how they come together, and just innovate in ways that we have a public report, so you're welcome to try. We have a HoloLens unit here. Thank you.
All right. You here in the audience, and you here at home, or on the bus, or wherever you're watching this video, please come to Eastside VR. We are doing it now on the second Tuesdays of the month.
Thursdays.
I get the T days mixed up, but thanks to KC for helping. Guide us to this one, and thanks once again to Apex Systems for providing us this space and the snacks, and we'll see you next time. Thanks to everyone.